Good evening. Welcome to the Good Friday service sponsored by the United Methodist Church, Westlake Village, and New Hope Lutheran Church, Agora Hills. You are invited to take a breath and center yourself upon God's Spirit. Come along with us as we remember our Lord's Passion. Open yourself to the truth for you, so the impact of that sacrificial love might nurture and strengthen your soul for the challenges of these days. This wrenching and awe-inspiring story begins to convey the truth to us that even the bleakest and the darkest of moment might hold within it a light which, when flamed, will conquer all darkness. That Easter promise awaits us. First, though, we must walk through Golgotha.
We come to the time in our worship where we take the moment to talk to God in prayer. I'm going to invite each and every one of us to take a moment of personal prayer where we consider what words we would say to Jesus today and on that day so long ago. Almighty God, hear our prayers for the church and for the world. Grant that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Guide the people in this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others, and to all your honor and glory. Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as Christ loves us. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. In mercy, receive all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. We pray all of these prayers through Jesus Christ, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Good evening. While our worship service may be virtual, The needs of God's people still remain, and we are called to meet those needs. The offering for this service will be used by the Kaneo Valley Interfaith Council to meet the needs of the organizations who serve homeless people in our communities. As you can imagine, the needs are even greater at this time than usual. Your check should be made out to the UMC of Westlake Village and mailed to the church. Alternate plans for giving online are also being shown on your screen.
Thank you for welcoming us into your home on this Good Friday. I want to thank our partners at the United Methodist Church, especially their leaders for hosting us tonight. I am grateful for our rare, maybe even unique relationship, our covenant that we have with one another. And on this night, when we celebrate those acts by which Christ has won the salvation of us all, it is good to be together. So thank you for welcoming us into your home, and thank you for your partnership. The reading this evening is from the 53rd chapter of the prophet Isaiah. He has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and was afflicted, yet did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a ewe that is silent before the shearers, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked, and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. This is the word of the Lord.
What wondrous love is this, O my soul? O my soul, what wondrous love is this, O my soul? What wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of bliss to bear the dreadful curse for my soul? For my soul, to bear the dreadful curse for my soul. What wondrous love is this, O my soul, O my soul? What wondrous love is this, O my soul? What wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of life to lay aside his crown for my soul, for my soul, to lay aside his crown for my soul? To God and to the Lamb I will sing, I will sing. To God and to the Lamb I will sing. To God and to the Lamb who is the great I am. While millions join the theme, I will sing, I will sing. While millions join the theme, I will sing. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing and joyful be. And through eternity, I'll sing on, I'll sing on. And through eternity, I'll sing on.
Jesus went forth with his disciples across the Kidron Valley, where there was a garden, where he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas, procuring a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to befall him, came forward and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When he said to them, "I am he," they drew back and they fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Who do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he, so if you seek me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word which he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of them who you gave to me." Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its sheath. Shall I not drink the cup which the Father has given me?"
So the band of soldiers and their captain and the officers of the Judean authorities seized Jesus and bound him. First they led him to Annas, for he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had given counsel to the religious authorities that it was expedient that one man should die for the people.
Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. As this disciple was known to the high priest, he entered the court of the high priest along with Jesus, while Peter stood outside the door. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out and spoke to the woman who guarded the gate and brought Peter in. The woman who guarded the gate said to Peter, "Are you not also one of this man's disciples?" He said, "I am not." Now the servants and officers had made a charcoal fire, because it was cold, and they were standing and warming themselves. Peter also was with them, standing and warming himself.
The high priest then questioned Jesus about his teaching and his disciples. Jesus answered him, I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogues and in the temple, where all Jewish people come together. I have said nothing secretly. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said. And when he had said this, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying, Is that how you answered the high priest? Jesus answered him, If I have spoken wrongly, bear witness to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me? Annas then sent Jesus, bound to Caiaphas, the high priest.
Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They said to him, Are not also you one of his disciples? He denied it and said, I am not. One of the servants of the high priest, a kinsman of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, Did I not see you in the garden with him? Peter again denied it, and at once the cock crowed.
They led Jesus from the house of Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early. They themselves did not enter the headquarters, so that they might not be defiled, but might eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, What accusation do you bring against this man? They answered him, If this man were not an evildoer, we would not have handed him over. Pilate said to them, Take him yourself and judge him by your own law. The religious authority said to him, It is not lawful for us to put any man to death. This was to fulfill the word which Jesus had spoken to show by what death he was to die.
Pilate entered the headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, Are you the king of the Jews? Jesus answered, Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me? Pilate answered, Am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done? Jesus answered, My kingship is not of this world. If my kingship were of this world, my servants would fight that I might not be handed over to the religious authorities. But my kingship is not from the world. Pilate said to him, So you are a king? Jesus answered, You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. Pilate said to him, What is truth?
After Pilate had said this, he went to the religious authorities again and told them, I find no crime in him, but you have a custom that I should release one man for you at the Passover. Will you have me release for you the king of the Jews? They cried out, Not this man, but Barabbas. Now, Barabbas was a robber.
Then Pilate took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head and arrayed him in a purple robe. They came up to him saying, Hail, hail, King of the Jews! And struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no crime in him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the officers saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no crime in him." The religious authorities answered him, "We have a law, and by that law he ought to die, because he has made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard these words, he was the more afraid. He entered the headquarters again, and he said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and the power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore, he who delivered me to you has the greater sin."
Upon this, Pilate sought to be released, but the religious authorities cried out, "If you release this man, you are not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king sets himself against Caesar." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at the place called the Pavement, and in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour. He said to the religious authorities, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." They handed him over to them to be crucified.
So they took Jesus, and he went out, bearing his own cross, to the place called the Place of a Skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus between them. Pilate also wrote a title and put it on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Judeans read this title, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. The Jewish chief priests then said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his garments and made four parts, one for each soldier, also his tunic, but the tunic was without seam, woven from top to bottom. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it, to see whose it shall be." This was to fulfill Scripture: "They parted my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots."
So the soldiers did this. But standing by the cross of Jesus was his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing near, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home.
After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said to fulfill Scripture, "I thirst." A bowl full of vinegar stood there, so they put a sponge full of vinegar on hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished," and he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Since it was the day of preparation, in order to prevent the bodies from remaining on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a high day, the religious authorities asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs, but one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out both blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth, so that you also may believe. For these things took place, that the Scriptures might be fulfilled, "Not a bone of him shall be broken." And again, another Scripture says, "They shall look on him whom they have pierced."
After this, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple but secretly for fear of the religious authorities, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him leave. So he came and he took away his body. Nicodemus also, who had at first come to him by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pounds weight. They took the body of Jesus, bound it in linen cloths with the spices, as in the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified there was a garden, and in the garden there was a new tomb where no one had ever been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, as the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there.
Well, there you have it. What wondrous love is this, O my soul, O my soul. God calls out to you. God calls out to us all. God beckons us to take love seriously as that which drives forward the world and as that which holds the key to redeem the world. Let love surround you, particularly these days. Let love lead your ways and help you find your way forward. Be safe, stay healthy, know that God loves you. Amen.